try and do our best. We will struggle with the PA system as it goes. Welcome to the Wirral West constituency. Welcome to the Wirral West Constituency Committee. A couple of things. I'm conscious we've got some guests. So what we'll try and do is move the agenda around so that Girtrell Court is brought forward quite early on in the agenda, if that's all right with everyone. Yep. I know Matthew and a number of colleagues of Chris and others have asked about doing that. So more than happy to do that. And also, like to draw people's attention, hopefully, to the special places presentation. And again, there with people's ideas for bench locations, etc., around Wirral West. We've asked them to come forward with suggestions. We've had almost 30, or we've had 30 already. And again, the bidding process is still open, so ideas need to be with us by the end of February. So there is some more time, but if you could get those ideas through, hopefully you agree that they're an excellent set of ideas we've had already. So if we move on to the technical part of the agenda, first thing to do is to invite members to declare any disclosable, pecuniary or non-pecuniary interest in connection with any items on the agenda and to state the nature of that interest. Any interest anywhere? I don't know, it was you declaring interest, was it, Phil?
Me.
All right. All right, in that case, if we can move on. Next item is the agreeing the minutes of the previous meeting. Again, colleagues, everyone had an opportunity to read those. Can we agree there was an accurate record?
Correct.
Okay, they agreed?
Yeah.
Okay, well, looks like
I'm
okay. There we go. Right, the next item on the agenda would be, let me have a look at this thing here, is the constituency manager's progress report, I think. Is it? Or yes, it will be. Yeah. So what I'd like to do, if that's okay with everybody, is to move the agenda around slightly and bring public question time forward, so I know there's colleagues from Girtrell Court here, so we can ask some questions around that, then we will adjourn the question time and put it back in its original spot, if that's okay. So, right, public question time. Is there somebody from the carers and users from Girtrell Court that are here? Is there someone who'd like to start off or ask a question about that? Yes, the young man at the far side there, and someone will find you with a microphone.
Hello, good evening, can you hear me?
Yes, very well.
Thank you, Chair. Really, this question is directed to Graham. Thank you for coming tonight, Graham. As you're aware, we attended the meeting at the Town Hall, where you gave a presentation about Girtrell. I did a 4-minute presentation myself, where I've been given a list on the 30th of December of the alternative proposals for respite instead of Girtrell Court. I spent a lot of time researching these properties, and I found at the end of my investigation that none was suitable for my son Mark, who is here. Mark has cerebral palsy, he's a wheelchair user. So therefore, one of the big factors is wheelchair accessibility. I was told at the meeting by Graham and his team that list was an old list and we would be given a new list at the end of the meeting. By giving it to us at the end of the meeting, obviously we couldn't look into it, therefore we couldn't make any challenges. Since looking through that list, again, it's inappropriate for my son, and also there are 51 users that use Girtrell who have either mobility problems or are wheelchair users. To add insult to injury, this list included 14 old people's homes. Now, would you really want disabled young men, my son is 33, being put in a nursing home with old people who have Alzheimer's or dementia? I think it's totally inappropriate, and I feel really insulted that places like that should be offered to us as an alternative. But if you go back a little bit earlier, I believe the council, the cabinet were misled to even make this decision, because I don't believe that the facts that they were given were complete. Whoever completed the research didn't complete, do a proper job in my estimation. They didn't check about availability for wheelchairs. And where they said there were vacancies, these vacancies were on the second or third floor of properties with no access. It's really totally inappropriate, and I really am ashamed that the council could put such a horrendous list forward. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. The gentleman at the back, if I may. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Chair. My name is David Jones. I'm a Wirral Unison rep within Adult Social Services. And I'm very concerned about the proposals to close Girtrell Court. Not only are the council proposing to make 46 staff compulsory redundant, and not just 46 staff, but staff that are valued, that are skilled, with 20, 30 plus years experience amongst them, valued by the people who use that service. That really concerns me, and concerns me that a Labour council is proposing to take that step. Beyond that though, I think it is really concerning about the impact on vulnerable people and the carers that support them, and I don't think that has been fully taken into account in terms of this proposal. The protecting vulnerable people is meant to be the top of the list of the priorities of this council. This proposal doesn't feel like that. The impact, you know, will be testified, I'm sure, throughout the rest of this meeting by many of the carers who are here. It's a ill-thought-out and ill-considered proposal, in my opinion. That can be evidenced by the fact that, in effect, the council have only started to undertake work to find a reprovisioning, alternative provision, whatever you call it, little more than in the past month. You know, the impact upon people is massive, and yet the preparation has only been happening in the last month. There are real concerns about the availability of alternative provision, as Reece has just elucidated quite well. That's not going to be found out until after Girtrell Court is closed. By then, it's too late for the people who are relying upon that service. We cannot go ahead with the proposals at this time. I think also it's important to notice that, you know, the council are making quite deep cuts in our services, and I know and I fully recognise the cuts that have been made in the budgets that have been passed down from the government, and I recognise that. But the figures for these cuts don't add up. It's reckoned that it's going to save, depending on which paper you open, whether it's 150,000 or 500,000. But the figures don't add up. There are real holes in the figures. The information that we've seen so far, which is only partial, we still can't get a breakdown for how the alternative respite is being costed out. The figures don't add up. And how can a council go ahead with a massive change for some of the most vulnerable people on this peninsula without being sure of the figures, without even being sure that it's going to make the savings that the promises? I'm concerned that we're putting people's lives before money, putting money before people's lives anyway, but the figures don't add up. And I would urge the whole of the panel, but in particular the two cabinet members, to seriously reflect on that and reject this proposal. It doesn't make sense, and the disruption is unjustified. Please think again, and on the 22nd of February, reject this proposal and leave Girtrell Court as the residents want it.
Thank you. gentleman at the end of this particular row, because that's had it for a while.
Don't need the mic, thanks. Yeah, I'm loud enough.
Well, if you could, because there are colleagues over there that,
all right,
that
okay.
Would it will help.
Yeah, that was very good from Dave there, and I'm going to come from this at a different, slightly different angle, but same as something similar to what Dave said there, and maybe explaining one or two things. My name is Phil Simpson, and I would like to put a question about the proposed closure of the Girtrell Court respite home. But before I come to my question, I'd like to take a couple of seconds just to inform people here of a few facts about Girtrell Court and proposed closure. Wirral Borough Council claims they have got to save £24 million from the budget over the next 12 months. And over the term of this Parliament, £126 million. And I'm sure you'll correct me if I'm wrong.
I have to tell you, my experience is the figures change quite dramatically.
Well, they might, yeah, might well do. They say by closing Girtrell Court, this is going to save £155,000 a year. However, earlier in this year, your own chief executive received a 30% pay increase.
Good Lord.
They paid over £200,000 in a gold handshake to a strategic director when weeks later he was re-employed at the Wirral Chamber of Commerce.
Who was that?
Further, they spent more than £130,000 on agency makers per week. They spent another £20,000 or more on consultants per week, not a year, per week. The council leader is so stressed with his job that he has employed a Labour Party campaigner to assist him on £45,000 a year. The increase announced in your council tax for this year is 4%. 2% of that is ring fence. But the very thing we are arguing about here, which would keep Girtrell Court open, it's the social care.
Yeah.
And finally, this council owns £124 million in reserve. £124 million in reserve. If £1 million of that £124 could be used for Girtrell Court, it would keep it open for more than 10 years. Now that's the fact. And there's no reason why that couldn't happen. So my question is, why are you discriminating against disabled people of our society when you spend over £240,000 on consultations for the golf resort and spa to enrich the lives of the healthy, fit and healthy? It's discrimination and it's a disgrace. And any Labour council or councillor who votes for this place to be closed, you are an absolute disgrace. You're a disgrace to the Labour movement and you should stop this now.
He's got Down syndrome. He's often doubly incontinent. He has no sense of danger. He's been run over twice because he just walks out into the road. My wife and I have loved and looked after David for the last 32 years, and God willing, we'll look after him for another 30 years. Yeah. Can I ask councillors who they think respite is for. Respite is two-edged. Respite is giving David a break from us, but equally it's giving my wife and I a break from a 24-hour a day, 7 day a week, 365 day a year caring responsibility.
Here, here.
We allow David to go to Girtrell because we trust the staff at Girtrell, we trust the regime at Girtrell. We know that when David goes to Girtrell, he goes with friends that he knows. There is a community there that he can join in with and relate to. The proposal that's being made by the council in terms of alternative provision, as Peter has quite eloquently said, involves a mishmash of old folks' homes, places with dementia, where the current service users of Girtrell will be parachuted in for 1 week occasionally. They will be going into a totally alien environment. We as carers will have no confidence that we currently have about the level of care that they will receive in those environments. Girtrell Court is a godsend to us. I'd like to ask the assembled audience here for a show of hands, who of you here are carers? Do you trust Girtrell Court?
Yes.
I'll pose a further question to the councillors. If you were proposing to close a service of such vital necessity, would not the logical thing to be to actually put in place an acceptable and valid alternative first before you decide to close the lifeline that we rely on? The decisions that have been made by DAS, possibly forced by budgetary constraints, although that is no excuse for them, do not give us a level of comfort that we need. They are totally illogical. I would plead with all the councillors, both here and in the rest of Wirral Council, to defer any decision on Girtrell closure for at least this next financial year, whilst you put something credible in place. That is the least we can expect of you. The chairman quite rightly said he doesn't want this to be a politically driven conversation. And I respect that. I have no party political affiliations whatsoever. But I will make you a promise now. If the Labour cabinet votes to close Girtrell, every one of the carers on Wirral will mobilise all of their friends, acquaintances, work colleagues to make democracy work for us come the May elections. Yes. Your majority, marginal as they may be, will be slashed by the carers who will take you to task for this appalling decision. Thank you for your time.
Okay, I'm going to take, I think we've got one more hand up, so we'll have one more hand up, and then we're going to go to Graham Hodgkinson. Do you want to, would you like to go first? You've been indicating a while.
Right, thank you very much for that. My name is Peter Cowan. I have a sister in Girtrell. She is 70 years of age this year. She is severely handicapped. She cannot fend for herself. She can't talk, she can't walk, can't feed herself, can't wash, can't do anything. And thank God we've got a place called Girtrell Court. We have a fantastic team that look after them. And what has been said by the past people, speakers here, I back them up to the hilt. When she's in there, and when she's in there, I am 100% relieved and confident she's getting the best of care. Now, if you send or you carry out your programme, send them out to all these hotels, Southport, Blackpool, holiday caravan sites in North Wales, this is ridiculous. Who is going to look after them? How the carers going to get out there to see their loved ones? Now, the other question is I want to ask is, the hotels, do they have hoists in there to lift the people out in the bed, out of the beds in the hotels? Do they have tipped up baths for these residents in Girtrell? No. And another one is, do they have a CRB? Right. We don't know. We don't know. We've got to trust them. I don't trust them. But I know the team in Wirral have all these qualifications. They can't, vast majority of the people there cannot talk. The staff only look into their eyes and they know immediately what their requirements are. There is a skill that cannot be replaced if you disband it. Money cannot replace that. I hear that you have £1 million to improve Girtrell. Why isn't that being spent? Early on last year, we were talking about building six bungalows or something. And I was told we don't have the money now, but initially you did. What happened? Has it been squandered? I don't know. Right. The other thing is, I'm sorry, I get very emotional and I become very mixed at times. Okay. I speak for all the people here, 140 of them, and our supporters here. What I'm going to say. Bear with me one moment, please. When these people are friends in Girtrell, if they go to these hotels and all that, they are open to abuse. If anything, if they have ill treatment or any other things, I don't have to say that, it's a nasty word, they are not able to turn around and tell anybody I've been abused or anything like that. So we remain confident with the staff we've got in Girtrell. So please, 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 do not close it. Thank you.
Something to say, I don't know why.
Okay, is that on? Yes. Okay. Good evening, everyone. My name is Graham Hodkinson. I'm the Director of Adult Social Services, and in many ways, the person that most of these questions are addressed to. I have met many of you before, and we've met Mr. Cowan. I met on a one-to-one with you and had a conversation about your sister and about the needs assessment that we need to do to make sure that she gets the right accommodation. I'm very aware of the needs that your sister has. And, there's no way that that hotel offer was anything to do with an offer for your sister. It's very much about the sort of care that she needs. It's very intensive, one-to-one support. I know that, and that's very clear. In terms of this whole meeting and how people feel, then, I absolutely recognise how strongly people feel about this and how upsetting this sort of process is. So I do need to recognise that. I also recognise that for the staff at Girtrell Court, it's a major issue and again, very upsetting for them. So the context of my responses are really to give some clear answers to the questions, but I do completely understand that level of upset. It's very clear that people value Girtrell Court, they value the staff and they value the quality of the service that they get there. Nevertheless, we are faced with huge levels of demand, and demand every year is increasing for adult social care, and the money that I've got to spend on social care is decreasing. And that, as well as the other facts that we discussed before, is actually a fact. So the budget that I have available for adult social care has reduced by £25 million over a five-year period, yet we're supporting lots more people. Now, one of the ways that I've been able to offer service to people and maintain that offer is by no longer delivering those services directly as a council, or getting those services from the independent sector, from voluntary sector organisations and private sector organisations, a mix of the two. We've done that for all of our domiciliary care, we've done it for all of our residential care for older people. We've provided supported living for people with learning disabilities, a whole range of different services. The only service that we currently directly deliver now is Girtrell Court. So part of this is that we are on a natural progression, as a council to commission his services from other organisations. Now, you may or may not agree with the ethics of that, but the fact is that when we put this proposal together, it costs, for every bed at Girtrell Court, it costs us about £1,500 a week. Even with the savings that I've identified, we'll still have £1,000 per week per bed for families that need respite care. So no one will not be getting respite care given. Anyone who requires respite will get respite. Now, there were lots of questions, and I completely understand, Peter, but that list of what's available in the market right now has some gaps in it. And I will be the first one to acknowledge that. All of the services that we require are not in that list. And I said at the time when I met with families on the 22nd of January that this is an indication of what's available in the market right now. I was very clear about that. And I said everyone will have a one-to-one needs assessment. Now, those needs assessments give us the picture in terms of what other services are required, so we can then commission new services. So we're not stuck with just the services that are in the market right now. We can buy new services, and this is something we've done time and time again as an organisation. So let me just say again, no one here that needs respite will not get a respite. And the needs that you've identified, so Peter, you've said, you know, my son, he needs wheelchair access, he needs support in a fully accessible environment, skilled people to do that, then that's what we need to commission. I can't leave you without that. I have to provide that, so I have to commission that. Now, in terms of the closure, there is no closure date for Girtrell Court. The decision that is being asked of the council is a budgetary decision. They will make that decision. I can't close Girtrell Court until we have the alternative services in place. So the needs assessment and then the commissioning of new services are absolutely bound up with whatever the closure plan is for Girtrell Court, should we get to there. So I think that those factors are very important, because a lot of the assumptions that people are making about how dire this is are incorrect. And because you said we're going to be left out of service, and absolutely everyone will get a service. We've got...
Okay.
Because you've all money in the end.
Okay.
Are you going to be liable for anything that happens?
Yes, he is, actually.
I'm not going to be quiet to people shouting out.
Can we just...
What an excuse.
Can we let Graham finish his answer? Then there'll be... To be honest, I haven't heard his answer yet. So I think other colleagues won't have heard his answer yet. So it is useful for us as well.
I have only answered some of the questions that were raised. So the one-to-one needs assessments are absolutely critical to building the picture of what we then need to commission. Once they've been complete, and they're not complete until the middle of March, once they're complete, we can then come out with our plan in terms of what the alternative provision would be. So that's very important. Now, there was also a question around the £2.2 million precept, and the 2% precept, which equates to £2.2 million, and what that's going to be used for. Now, every year we work with all of our providers, and we find out what their inflationary costs are, we find out what their pressures are as organisations. And this year, and for the next few years, they've all got to meet the cost of the living wage, the national living wage. It's an absolute requirement for them. The whole of that money will be used in order to pay for the sector, to pay for care. So that doesn't give me any extra money. On top of that, I also have every year round about £1 million worth of new people coming through with disabilities, and round about £1 million worth of new people, older people coming through that need support. So I've got to find ways to make the money that I've got available to me to stretch further. So that's why this plan, this whole approach, is to say, I need to make the money that I use for respite, I need to make it stretch further, and that's simply what I've got to do. David raised issues about the staff from Unison, and I have to fully acknowledge that the impact on staff is significant here. Because as a department we don't employ direct care staff anymore, then the potential for redundancy is very high for this staff team, and I would fully acknowledge what David said, A, about the quality of the workforce, but also B, about the impact on them as well.
Okay, thank you very much, Graham. What I'd like to do now is just pick up a few comments from around the from the committee, if we have any. I've got some views, and then maybe we can come together, coalesce around something we can send back to the cabinet, having heard what we've heard. So I know there are a couple of questions asked directly of cabinet members that are here. I don't know whether you've got anything you'd like to say, particularly Tony, Stuart.
Yeah, okay, thanks, Chair. Councillor Tony Smith. My name is Councillor Tony Smith. Yes, I'm one of the Cabinet members, and what I would say is that at the moment we are asked for consultation, so nothing has been decided. I make that very, very clear. Nothing has been decided. And as Graham has just said, every person in Girtrell Court will have an individual assessment, and whatever happens, there will be alternative provision for people, the right provision. But I emphasise very, very carefully that no, the consultation is still going on, nothing has been decided, and we're here to listen tonight.
Okay,
write a reply, please.
Well,
it's an important point.
If it's short, if it's very short, I want colleagues to have an opportunity. Right.
Thank you. At the moment, no bookings are being taken by Girtrell Court post-March. None of the carers here can plan their coming year. None of us can book breaks. None of us can book holidays. None of us can book social engagements. The correct, right and courageous thing for this council to do is to defer the closure for a minimum of 6 months and present a valid, fully worked out, fully costed and fully consulted solution before you close. And in the meantime, continue to allow respite to people who desperately need it.
We are in consultation at the moment, and I would hope, and maybe Graham will concur with this, that nothing can be decided until the consultation is finished.
That's correct.
So this is a bit preemptive, I think. What's come across to me tonight is the strength of feeling, and there's been, what I might say, there's been some very valid points made from the floor. Very valid indeed, which will weigh out heavily on myself if I come to make a decision. So it's heartened me that nothing will be decided or agreed upon or voted upon until the consultation and the process is done in full. But I would like, just one more thing, Chair. If there's no more bookings being taken after March, that sounds to me like a concern, because I appreciate you can't book your summer holidays or breaks. So I think I'll certainly take that back. Thank you. Thanks, Jeff.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Louise?
The only thing I want to say is, obviously, being a carer to disabled children, I'll be looking out for the future of my children as well and where they're going to go. So I'll be watching this very, very closely. It does concern me, and I do know lots of the people in the audience, so it does concern me. So I'll be looking at it from a personal point of view. We're also on your side. I know how it feels to be a carer. I know how it feels to have care cut and be left. I also know how it feels not to be able to plan, not to be able to plan for tomorrow, certainly not to be able to plan for the next year. Is traumatic, and lots of carers are getting on, and as are the person they're cared for. So we need to make sure that there's something in the future. It's not easy getting older, and not knowing where your young person, where your person you're caring for is going to be in the future. So I'll be watching with intrigue.
Thank you. And I could just, I mean, I've got something to say a bit later on, but again, to say no decision's been made, it's all for consultation, then not accept bookings does seem a bit, to me, a bit of confusion. It seems to me like somewhat expected decision to be made, even if it hasn't been. So, could I just, again, just to, Eddie, have you got something you want to say? Someone better give him a mic, I think.
No, I think I'll be able to shout loud enough.
No, but there's people over there.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jeff. The big problem you've got here is a noise, is the not knowing. That is the biggest problem at all. And I just find it very difficult that the Cabinet and the senior members of the Cabinet have not come up with a decision. They're leaving everyone absolutely in the... There's nothing going on at all. You're all upset, you're all worried, you don't know which what's going on. You've got the staff, and certainly I don't think I could do their job. I just haven't got the patience to do their job. But as everyone is saying, they just don't know. I'm quite sure somewhere around the line we can find the money for it. They must be somewhere around the line. And I'm quite sure that if you can come up with a decision to defer it and say, right, we're going to look at the 6 months, and there's one or two gentlemen who've been up and spoke very well indeed, that surely we can defer this, which will give them all the chance to rethink. But at the present moment, there is not, they just don't know what's going on. Thank you.
Just a quick word, Jeff, on my Twitter.
To the bottom.
Okay, that on?
To the very bottom.
Okay. If you can hear me now, yeah. I'm Councillor Gerry Ellis from Hoylake and Mells ward, which is the adjacent ward to this, but we have got a number of our residents who do go to Girtrell Court. I have heard enough tonight to just say to the two Cabinet members who are sitting here and the Director, look, you know what it's all about. You've heard all of this. You know you're making a terrible mistake. And why don't you just go back to the Leader of the Council and tell him the Leader of the Council has, to his great credit, reversed some of his decisions which turned out to be unpopular last year. I'm sure he'll do the same again. If you go back and tell him that there's been a terrible mistake here, we don't want Girtrell Court to close. The people here have said they've told you the truth. You must take this away, and you must stop this right away, and you must reopen. You must reopen the bookings for after March onwards. It would be a disgrace if you didn't do that. Thank you.
Wendy.
Okay. Some years ago, a friend of mine used to go to Girtrell Court, and I visited it there, and I was always very impressed with the care and the real concern that was shown for her and for her well-being. So I'm rather attached to Girtrell Court, but at the same time, I'm really attached to the fact that the council says its priority is to care for the vulnerable in our community, and I'd be heartbroken if I thought we're not going to do that. So, folks, you have my support.
Well, I'll be quite honest. I didn't appreciate just how important the work that Girtrell Court did up until fairly recently, so I will hold my hands up. But I do have a close neighbour who uses the facility, and to say that they were on their knees in tears when they heard the news was probably an understatement. And to be perfectly frank, it's quite upsetting for me to even think about how she reacted to the news. It was as though somebody had died. And I think it's not too difficult to say that Girtrell Court is probably a very good friend of most of the people in this room, whether they be users or whether they be the parents and loved ones of users. And to lose it, given the fact that, as I say, we are all in the belief that the council looks after its most vulnerable people, I find quite staggering. And it really is possible to reverse this decision. I fully understand that we have to be watching money, but some things are just too important, I believe, to allow to go. And once it's gone, I'm afraid it won't be coming back. So we need to make sure the precedent hasn't been set.
Yes, Chair, I can only echo what's already been said. When I heard that the possibility was on the cards of Girtrell Court was going to be closed, I really couldn't believe it. And having heard even more tonight about all the good work it does, how important it is to people, both the people themselves and also the carers, particularly the carers, I really can't believe that we'd possibly let this go. And to think of losing the expertise of the dedicated staff is absolutely terrible. So I'm even more than I felt before I came to this meeting, I'm absolutely determined it should not be closed.
There's no doubt at all that members of the audience have made very cogent points in support of maintaining Girtrell Court. To declare a slight interest, she doesn't reside at Girtrell Court, but one of my 8 grandchildren is Down syndrome, and I appreciate what he's done for her in her region of the country. So there's no question, in my view, that Girtrell Court should not remain open. The only thing, without speaking to what everybody else has said, my main concern is the suggestion that no decision has yet been made on this, yet you're not taking any further bookings after March. That, to me, is something that I would find totally unacceptable. Unless a decision is made, there should be no question about not taking people after March. I recommend to Graham, if he's here and he's got any influence, and the Cabinet members, that that part of the decision is immediately reversed and that they continue taking people until some better alternative has been fully researched, responded to, consulted upon, and agreed. And I would like that minuted, if we may, Chair.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
The first duty of any local authority is the protection of those in need. And the people here tonight who've seen and heard from their carers and their relatives, mothers and fathers, have every right to expect that to be the case. I went into Leeso Children's Hospital at the age of 8, and I didn't emerge from there until I was 13 with TB. And there were some people there similar to some of the people here tonight, and I got to know a few of them, and they were great kids. Now, it was in 1947, and the older ones, most of you are very young, but there are a few older ones here. We'll remember that in 1947, immediately after the war, this country was on its knees. We were broke, we were rationing, you couldn't get anything. But in a hospital, in that Leeso hospital, because I was in need and the others were in need, we had marvellous treatment. And I think that's what Girtrell Court gives. And we should be no different than the public sector body that looked after me in 1947. We should be looking after the children and the grown-ups at Girtrell Court as long as they're wanted there. And I think they're very badly wanted there, judging by what we've heard tonight. And this decision must be changed.
Thank you, everyone, because I think it's been a very informative and quite emotional set of questions. We've heard the response from Graham and the officers